Good morning.
Good morning.
It's so good to be with you all. Buenos dias.
Buenos dias.
That's a warm up for our chorus later in Spanish. It's so good to be with you here on New Year's Eve to end 2023 and kind of start thinking about what God is going to be doing in our lives in 2024. So we're so thankful to be worshiping with you all this morning. We're going to start with a reading from Psalm by Josiah Becker.
In Psalms 90, chapter 98, verse 1, 2, and 3, it says, "Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed the righteousness of the nation, to the nation. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God."
Amen. Thank you, Josiah. Would you stand and sing with us? Come, now is the time to worship. And be prepared for the Spanish chorus, okay? Ven.
Power in us. within us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. We are your churches, and we are the hope on earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Shall your mighty hand heal our streets and land? Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray.
Amen. You would be seated.
We have a couple announcements we want to share with you about things. You know, this time of year, every year, we challenge you to set spiritual goals. We are all growing as disciples of Jesus. We're progressing in our sanctification and our holiness. And so it's a good thing to set goals for a new year. And so out on the welcome stand, out in the entryway, there's this paper, and it's just some examples of spiritual goals that you might consider and just how they can be accomplished. And we really emphasize making them measurable. So for instance, you can't just say, I want to read my Bible more this year. No, make it measurable. Say, I plan to read my Bible at least 10 minutes every morning and then record it in a journal that I'm going to buy. That type of thing. So we challenge you to set some goals for your own spiritual growth and let us know if there's some way that we can help you in that as we all progress in holiness. So anyways, this paper is out in the entryway, and please pick one of these up on the way out. Now, there is a service project coming up, and this is actually something that young people are doing at Prevailing Church in Inkster, but we are all invited to join them. And so if you'd like to come out this Friday night, starting at 5 p.m. at Prevailing Church in Inkster, we'll be doing some different work projects. I know they have a food pantry, and we'll be working in there and a couple other things. So if you'd like to join us. And then after that, there's actually a game night with some of the folks that'll be there from the church. And I don't plan to stay for that, but you all are invited to stay for the game night too. All right, and then we want to let you know that next Sunday, Sunday school starts again at the 11:15 hour. And the adult Sunday school class that will be starting next week is on unity based on 1 Corinthians. So we hope you'll make that a priority to stay after the 10 o'clock service for the new Sunday school class that's starting out. All right, today's New Year's Eve, and we want to sing a song for you called New Year's Day. And it's about how God is a God of second chances. And some of you need to hear that this morning, that God is a God of second chances. He's a God of new beginnings. And that's what this song is about. I buy a lot of diaries,
fill them full of good intentions.
Each and every New Year's Eve,
I make myself a list
of all the things I'm gonna change until January 2nd. So this time I'm making one promise. This will be my resolution. Every day is New Year's Day. This could start it. Possible, 'cause I believe in new beginnings. I believe in Christmas Day and Easter morning too. And I'm convinced it's doable, 'cause I believe in second chances, just the way that I believe in you. My resolution every day.
change and grow. One more chance to grab a hold of grace and never let it go. Oh. And this will be my resolution. Every day is New Year's Day. This could start a revolution. Every day is, every day is, every day is New Year's Day. Hey.
Okay, so I'm noticing that last weekend, this week, we have all the kids in the service. So I was wondering if the kids would help me a little bit this morning. We're going to sing, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High. And I have a bunch of instruments over here. And I wonder if you're a kid in the audience and you want to, if you would come up, grab an instrument, and help me lead this next song. Any kids brave enough to come on up here and play a little instrument with us?
Percussive help.
Yeah, guys. Jamie needs help. He can't do the percussion. And then, so we have here in the front, we have a tambourine. We have some shakers. We have, I don't even know what some of that stuff is. Some.
Sounds so good.
One of these. Yeah, come on up. Okay, let's see. Take a look at what instrument you could play. If not, if you know the motions to Lord, I Lift Your Name on High, that could be really helpful. Of course, I'm going to need the adults' help, too. So if you guys would stand up, and we're going to do the motions all together, okay?
I have a stand up here.
Oh, yeah.
Here, kids.
Okay, guys, stand up here.
Lift your name on high, and I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us, Jesus. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross.
Percussion section.
Excellent, yeah, excellent. We should have the kids in here every Sunday, guys.
I know, this is fun.
Go on up to the mountain of mercy, to the crimson perpetual tide. Kneel down on the shore, be thirsty no more. Go under and be purified. Follow Christ to the holy mountain. Sinners sorry and wrecked by the fall. Cleanse your heart and your soul in the fountain that flows for you. we're atoned by His blood and forever washed white on that beautiful, scandalous night. On the hillside you will be delivered, at the foot of the cross justified, and your spirit restored by the river that pours from our blessed Savior's side. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me, we're atoned by His blood and forever washed white on that beautiful, scandalous night. At the wonderful, tragic, mysterious tree, on that beautiful, scandalous night, you and me, we're atoned by His blood and forever washed white on that beautiful, scandalous night. On that beautiful, scandalous night.
Lord, we thank you so much for this opportunity to worship together, to reflect on all the things that you have done in this year, 2023, and all the things that you are going to do in 2024 through us and around us that we get to be a part of, Lord. I pray for John and Chris as they bring the word, Lord, and I just thank you because we recognize what a privilege it is to be here singing and worshiping and hearing the word and reading scripture together, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we have a Real Life Minute by John Becker.
Hi, good morning. I'm John Becker. After my graduation from college, I took a job in D.C. for about a year. I was a Snyder's of Hanover pretzel delivery truck driver. It's not really too pertinent to the story, but that's what I did. During that year, I was also very involved in the church and prayerful about being a little more effective with my regular time in ministry. So through all that time in prayer, I then took a job out in California with an organization called Advent Group Ministries. I worked there for 9 years. Advent specializes in working with alcoholic and addict teens, mostly gang kids who are on probation, generally the kind of kids you would like your kid not to be connected with. So I had the blessed opportunity of ministering to these kids. And during that time as a missionary, predominantly, I didn't really think about spiritual goals, life goals, or any of those other kinds of dynamics. It was really such a life spent simply in service, which was really beautiful. And then God awakened me to additional life or additional ministry, because that's where I met my beautiful wife, and then we're able to be connected, married. Now I have my 3 kids. But also in addition to this, I now am also in private practice with my own business. And through all of that, came across, business trainings and things like that about how to grow business. And you should set some goals. And it's really refreshing when the Holy Spirit puts something on your heart, because I always know when God is prompting me, because thoughts come into my mind that are not mine, or love comes into my spirit that is also not mine. I usually think about it this way. I'm like, I'm not that smart, so that must have been God probing me. And I'm also not that loving either, so that must be also God probing me into actions of love. And then so through that, I started to develop like business goals, and then the Spirit prompted me like, why are you not doing this in other areas of your life? And so through that, I then began to kind of categorize my life in order to put more intention into my living. And so I started to set then spiritual goals. And I also broke down my life into these different categories. I would set 3 goals each year. So I had 3 spiritual goals each year. I categorized my marriage as far as 3 goals to develop my marriage. Parenting goals, business, financial, self-health, care goals, different categories like this. Setting 3 goals each year in order to put intention into my living. And it's been very refreshing to be able to live a little bit more intentionally, recognizing that, I call them, these entities of life do not just develop on their own. God will work, but I also need to make sure that I'm fixing my eyes upon Christ, fixing my eyes upon God, fixing my eyes upon Jesus. The world otherwise will cause my eyes to get fixed everywhere else. And while there are these entities, everything still in our lives should really be focused on ministry. And so each year I try to do this. Now, honestly, the last couple of years, because of my broken leg and all the recovery and everything like that, this has been completely like thrown out the window while I've been working on re-recovering. But I'm looking forward to this year to getting back to looking at all of this. And again, looking at my life as far as how can I continue to bring Christ into all of these entities, my spiritual life, my marriage, my parenting, business, financial, the way in which I care for the temple of God. I want this temple to be effective so that I can be effective, which is our self-care, our health. And so I would encourage you to think, as we're embarking just tonight on a new year, to be thinking about living more intentionally. Think about the different aspects of your life. Think about different goals that you could set for those aspects of your life. And it's also important, when you're setting these particular goals, to be connected with some loved ones in order to talk about this stuff. The things that are our goals become more effective when we actually share them with other people, so that we can increase our own accountability, but also we can experience a greater sense of love. Accountability is love. So when you share it with other people, they can, with great love, say, hey, how you doing? How are your goals this year? How is your life coming along? How is it that you are making sure that Christ is touching all aspects of your life rather than just being pushed aside? So I'd encourage you to think about that going into 2024. Thank you.
It's a little better. Can you hear me? All right, there we go, there we go, there we go. All right, that's not going to make this awkward or more anxious for me at all, not at all. Right? Resolve to reflect Christ, rethinking New Year's resolutions. John did an awesome job of kind of setting the table for me, kind of alluded to some of the things that I'm going to be talking about this morning. And let me open up my notes. All right. And let's switch to the next slide. So Dean, during the Christmas series, started to help us to reimagine taking some of our present holidays, days that are already set aside, days that we already have like traditions and practices around them, and to kind of rethink them. Rethink them for similarly how God had Israel set aside days and use those days for practice and worship and dedication. So I like that idea. And so basically I'm doing the same thing with New Year's Day and New Year's resolutions. I'm saying, what would it look like if we took New Year's Day and kind of repurposed it, reimagined it, and maybe did some of the same things, still create New Year's resolutions, but rethink how we go about setting New Year's resolutions. And that's what's this gonna be like today. But before I kind of get into it, and this might be a little bit, it might feel a little bit choppy because of the way I have this message set up, but I think it'll be easy enough to follow. One of the things I wanted to share with you, particularly from this slide here, was this epiphany that that I had not long ago. You guys that know me. I love to study theology. And somewhere along the way in my journey in studying theology, I was introduced to the notion that theology is profoundly practical. When we think about theology, I think that we often subconsciously think about how it's effectively divine command. You know, God said it, that settles it, I believe it, right? I have to order my life after it in light of the fact that God commanded it. And that's certainly true. But one of the things that you'll notice with this little pattern here that kind of helps us to think about Israel's holy days, their days of worship that they're set aside, is that if you pay close attention, their days were actually associated with very practical aspects of their lives. They were an agrarian society. A lot of their survival was reliant upon them growing crops. So if you actually look very closely, you'll see that most of their holidays are associated with, hey, it's time to till the ground. In other words, there's no refrigerator. There's no effective way to store long-term large amounts of food for sustainability of a society. So as the grain and everything from the previous year is kind of getting low, and they have to prepare for this new year upcoming of growing grains, you have the Day of Atonement. You have this day where you have to come together and repent and to present yourself before God. And part of the thought of this is, hey, let's forgive our sins and God will give us a good year of crops, right? Then you see the rainy season, you see the planting season, you see the early harvest season, and along with each harvest, if you pay close attention, you'll see there's these holy days that's associated. Hey, it's time for the olives to be harvested. It's time for the grapes to be harvested. It's time for the barley to be harvested. So their holy days, their religious practices were very practical. They had very practical meaning and purpose behind it. And I think it's valuable for us not to lose sight of that, because I think that often we might think it far away from us rather than very close and near and dear, because it's about our everyday lives. Our worship, the way that we serve and honor God and worship God, is closely associated with our survival and the things that we do, our jobs, the very things that we do to survive. So that was just one point that I thought might be helpful for us, almost like the way moving forward for me after I learned this, as I'm continuing to read scriptures and I'm continuing to think about God and to lean into ways of worship, I recognize one of the ways that I can really explore ways to worship God is through these very practical, everyday things. I can worship God through that. And so later on when I'm kind of offering some ideas for resolutions, it's going to be along those lines. Next slide. So in order for me to kind of get us into this mindset of resolution, I wanted to kind of at the very least give us a text. I didn't want to preach an entire sermon without us having some text to think about this with. So one of the things, what I did, I searched resolve and voila, I found a passage. And then I thought it was helpful when I considered the context of that passage. So this is Malachi chapter 2. If you do not listen and if you do not resolve to honor my name, says the Lord Almighty, I will send a curse on you, and I will curse your blessings. Yes, I have already cursed them, because you have not resolved to honor my name. So this is what Yahweh tells Israel, and it's helpful for us to think about when God is telling this to Israel. So we know the story in a nutshell. You know, God called Abraham. God gave this great privilege role to Abraham's descendant, that he was going to make them a nation of priests. Exodus, what's that, 19:6? I'm going to make you a nation of priests. Priests are mediators. They're the go-in between God and the rest of humanity. And then later on, it calls us a holy, a royal priesthood in Peter, right? So we have, God has had a community of priestly people. And this community of priestly people were supposed to be a light to the nations. They were supposed to be the people who lived, whose very way of life would draw in people around them. People around them would see the righteousness, the justice, the love, the way that they loved their neighbor and cared for others and not just themselves. People would see that, and people would want to come and join their community. But we know the story. God, not only did God give them this calling, he blessed them. He put them in this land flowing with milk and honey, this land where wealth where a high quality of life was right at their fingertips, a blessing, a gift from God to them. And how did they return God's favor? How did they return God's blessing? They lost sight of God. In their everyday lives, the way that they lived, they got consumed with life for their own purposes and not for the purpose of God. So what did God do? God sent them off into captivity. They spent 70 years in captivity, and then God brought them back out. He brought them back into land, said, I taught you a lesson. Now let's try this again, right? And so this is where this story picks up. After all of this, after years of God, bringing out this people, placing them in this land flowing with milk and honey, giving them this calling as a nation of priests, help giving them everything they needed. They lost sight. They lost focus on God. They started to live for themselves. He punished them, exiled them, brought them back. And here they are again. After all of this, here they are again, losing sight of God. Losing sight of this calling to be a nation of priests. Living for themselves. Living like the people around them. If you know this passage, this is the famous tithe passage, right? If you look at some of the critiques in this passage, later on, he talks about, hey, you guys aren't being faithful to the wife of your youth. You guys aren't paying your employees fairly. You guys are bringing terrible offerings to me, offerings that you wouldn't give to your own neighbor. You treat them with more dignity and respect than you treat with me. How does a people who have been so blessed by God lose sight? It's according to this passage, one of the reasons is because they had not resolved. They had not resolved in themselves that I have to be intentional, as John just pointed out. I have to be very intentional about living for God, because if I don't, I can lose sight. I can get lost in the sauce, as they say. I can miss the forest for the trees. Next slide. With that, what I wanted to do is to offer us some ideas about resolutions that would be sort of like missional oriented. Recognizing we all have a call, and that call is to be priests of God, to mediate, to represent, look like God down here on earth for the express purpose of introducing other people to God so that other people would come in and know. You all know I'm a missionary, so my job is to do that. So it's easier for people to think, oh, that's the job of the missionary, but actually it's the job of all God's people. Even in Israel, there's a priestly people, and then the entire nation is a priest. And the church is no different. There's people who vocationally work for God, and then there's the rest, all of us, who all work for God and all have the same calling and responsibility to reflect God to the lost people in Israel. So here's three missional type ideas. This is just a couple of things that I picked out that I thought, this would be helpful for us to reflect. And so I'm going to take us on a little survey of each one of these topics so that we can kind of wrap our minds around them a little bit better. Some of them might seem a little bit abstract and such, and hopefully we can kind of overcome some of that today. So next slide. The first one that I wanted to share and offer for you guys to consider as a New Year's resolution is wisdom. Have you ever considered why there's a block of books in the Bible called the wisdom literature? For most of my walk, I hadn't. For most of my walk, you know, someone somewhere along the way said, hey, there's 31 Proverbs. That's because there's 31 days in a month. That way you can read one a month, one each day of the month, and at the end of the month you'll get through the Proverbs. And I can recall early on reading the Proverbs and thinking to myself, that's not very helpful. Partly because a lot of the Proverbs center on life in the world in which they were written. And again, that's kind of an agrarian world. That's in a world where growing crops and, I mean, there are some shared values like justice and things like that. But more or less, it was kind of a foreign world to me. So it didn't resonate with me what the wisdom that the actual books like the Proverbs were offering. But through, you know, continuously reading them and my joy of exploring theology and beginning to understand their world a little bit better, I began to appreciate them a lot more and see the significance of them. Furthermore, I began to realize that the scriptures, the wisdom is sort of a theme in scriptures. It's sort of a theme. And it's a theme because it's something that God, it's something like righteousness, the way we think of righteousness. God wants us to reflect his righteousness down here on earth, right? It's nothing to do with our salvation, but it all has to do with our representation. We represent God. God is the righteous God. He wants us to look like him so others know what God's offering to them. God is the all-wise God. He also wants us to exude wisdom. What is wisdom, you might ask? One way of thinking about it is skill. When the Israelites were building the temple, they would often use the word wisdom and when they were referring to skilled laborers. This person can really craft an image that's going to be in the design of the temple. This person was a skilled musician. This person played the instrument really good, and they're going to be in service of the Lord at the temple. So one way to think about wisdom is to think of it as skill. And in that sense, all of us adults, and probably the kids too to some degree, we all usually have a particular skill. Think of whatever you do for vocationally, whatever you do for a living. If you're an engineer, you're skilled at engineering. If you are a musician, if you're a preacher, Dean's skilled at speaking. You know, all of us have our skills. But beyond that, we also have the capacity to be skilled in many other areas. We can be skilled at being a husband. We can be the type of person who has understanding and maturity so that when we see someone else who could use some advice and use some help, could use some wisdom, we're the people that can step in and offer that on behalf of God, can reflect God, can do the same thing for others that God has been doing for us. Wisdom wisdom is so vital and important. You know, the first, 8 chapters of the book of Proverbs is sort of this story of wisdom being personified as this woman searching the society that she's a part of, looking for people, calling for people, come, listen to me, come, participate, come, learn wisdom. This is the part of the opening of the book of Proverbs. Out in the open, wisdom calls aloud. She raises her voice in the public square on top of the wall. She cries out at the city gate. She makes her speech. How long will you who are simple love your simple ways? How long will mockers delight in mockery and fools hate knowledge? Repent at my rebuke. Then I will pour out my thoughts to you. I will make you known to my teachings. Wisdom is this great opportunity for us to reflect God down here on earth. And again, it might feel a little bit abstract, but what it is, it's being good at giving good advice. It's figuring out life and loving your neighbor enough to be willing to share. Not to say to yourself, I'm busy, someone else can go help solve this person's problem. But seeing these opportunities to solve other problems as blessings, as a part of our missional calling to go and serve other people. So, wisdom. Next slide. All right. Here's one quick example of how the Bible, you know, positions wisdom. This is Deuteronomy chapter 5. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 5 through 6. See, I have taught you decrees and laws as the Lord my God commanded me, so that you may follow them in the land you are entering to take possession of it. Observe them carefully, for this will show your wisdom and understanding to the nations, who will hear about all these decrees and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. See how the Bible posits wisdom as this thing that's supposed to be seen visually by others that don't know God so that it can draw them in. Next slide. One of the blessings about serving God is that God is eagerly waiting to give us wisdom. If we don't have it, James 1 says, if anyone lacks wisdom, you should ask God who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Just all we have to do is ask. We ask, And then we continue to do what we should be doing as is, studying the Bible, reading the Ecclesiastes, the Proverbs, the Psalms, Song of Solomon, these books that began to cultivate our minds to understand wisdom. James 3 and 13 says, "Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by the deeds done in humility that come from wisdom." So wisdom, that's one missional type idea, one missional type thing that we can choose to be as a resolution. I am going to grow in wisdom. Okay? I do want to offer one quick warning about wisdom. Every age, like if you think about in 1 Corinthians where Paul is opening up the book, he's talking about the wisdom of this world, the wisdom of the Jews, the wisdom of the Greeks, and the wisdom of this age. And he gives this warning. Hey, the wisdom of this age is seductive. What does he mean by that? He's warning them not to be seduced by the wisdom of this age. Because there are people in our epoch of time that sound smart. They sound like they got good ideas. They sound like they got the right way and the right path of life. But in reality, it's false. But on the surface, it seems right. So be careful as you explore wisdom, because there is a wisdom of this age, and that's something that we have to be on the guard against. Right. Next slide. Peer discipleship is a second thing that I want to offer as a potential resolution. Okay, what is peer discipleship? Peer discipleship is side-by-side discipleship. It's mutual discipleship, a relationship where each person helps another follow Jesus better, not based on a significant level of higher maturity, but because they are able to speak the truth with care and empathy, even when they are in a similar stage of their spiritual life. That's peer discipleship. Next slide. To put it, you know, really, really simple and kind of accessible to us, you know, it's when you develop a relationship with another brother or sister in the Lord where you can confess your sins, where you can pray intimately for one another, where you can study the Bible together or books related to the Bible together, where you can broaden your networking, how you advance and how you interact within the church. Next slide. This is a picture of me and John O. Martin. A lot of you might know him. He used to be here a while ago. We were actually mimicking this picture over here on the right. Some of you might even know that picture, right? So one morning, John O. used to be on the AV team. Go back to the last time. I'm going to tell a story about me and John O. So John used to be on the AV team. And every now and then I'll interact with him. And at some point in time, we both discovered that we had this affection for apologetics. And based on this, we were like, maybe we should get together, because we both seem to like this and no one else around here kind of talks about apologetics, right? So we were like, all right, so let's get together. And so we started at this point. And matter of fact, and if you look in our hands, the book we have is I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, one of my favorite books. So we got together. We said, hey, we're going to go through this book and we're just going to, you know, pray for each other and we're going to just talk about life. So we started that day. I think this is maybe from like 2013, maybe this picture here. And this may have been maybe like toward the end of the year, the first year that we started getting together to have these peer discipleship meetings. We didn't think of it as that at the time, but ultimately that's what it was. I vividly remember the day that we kind of transitioned from, you know, two Christians spending time together, hiding who they really were, because, you know, you don't want people to really know who you really are. You know, that's hard stuff about you. I remember it very vividly. We're sitting there at the table, we're eating, and John clears his voice, and he goes, "Chris, I got to tell you something." And, you know, I have no clue what to expect. I'm smiling like, sure. And then John confesses a sin to me, the type of sin that you wouldn't want to confess to another person. And so, you know, I don't know what it was. Maybe it was the Holy Spirit. I don't know. I, in turn, thought I should confess a sin to him. So I immediately, in response, confessed a sin to him. I think we both took this big, deep sigh of relief, because after confessing our sins, neither of us picked up stones to stone the other person. Neither of us ran back to the elders to get the other one exiled. But we, you know, from that point moving forward, every week we were confessing sins. We were becoming more transparent, more authentic, and our spiritual lives truly began to grow. yes, we were already studying the Bible. We were already studying these other biblical topics that were valuable. But it was really when we crossed that barrier of authenticity, of genuinely opening up and saying, this is laying bare who we actually are in an effort to grow in Christ, that we began to truly bond together and we began to truly grow. Since then, I don't remember a time that I haven't had peer discipleship. Since then, I've gone from when John relocated to Pennsylvania, I had to find someone new. From that point, I started with Josh. We started with a group, Jason Ardanowski and a few other guys. Now I'm meeting with Chad, John Becker, Josh. And one of the things that I've learned from that first experience with Jono is not to wait so long to get to that point where you cross that barrier of just being transparent. And then also, when you cross that barrier, usually it opens others up to cross that barrier. So use some wisdom in picking someone. The beauty is you get to pick the person. You get to pick who you get to meet with or the group of people that you get to meet with. But I want to highly encourage you to consider peer discipleship. It's been so transformative for me personally. And to this day, I still have a really, really great relationship with Jono. He supports the missionary work that I do. Whenever I'm in the Pennsylvania or Virginia area that's close by, I'll drive over and visit with him and Debbie. We're friends to this day because of the peer discipleship relationship that we found ourselves in, you know, unexpectedly. But again, I want to encourage you. Here's another missional type of resolution that I want to offer you to consider. Pick someone, meet with them regularly, open up, be transparent, and see how God will grow both of you in many ways. Next slide. Dean mentioned earlier during the announcements, Prevailing Church. This is a picture from Christmas Eve, last Sunday, at the Prevailing Church. The Prevailing Church is a very poor church. I know this because I helped manage their finances. That wasn't a skill that Pastor Sykes had, and I saw an opportunity to offer support. He graciously offered me the privilege of supporting him in that way. Since then, I created a spreadsheet and came to the conclusion, and he's okay with me sharing this, that they operate at a deficit. They operate at a deficit. And not only do they operate at a deficit, they operate at a deficit with Pastor Sykes being bivocational. And so a lot of the support of the church comes out of his own pockets. And they yet and still, they operate at a deficit. And, you know, by the grace of God, you know, we're partners with them in some ways. And we go over there and fix things and clean things and offer help in a variety of ways. But even him, even in their limited capacity, this is a Christmas party. Pastor Dean, he's bivocational. He works in Detroit Public Schools as a conflict counselor. And he has this heart, this passion for helping young boys who he wants to, if he can, alter the course of their lives by putting a male figure in their lives, someone who's deeply passionate and invested. And so that's what he feels called to do, even with his limited resources. So on Sunday mornings, Pastor Dean, he'll borrow buses from families at this church sometimes, and he drives all the way up to the east side where the school that he's at, which is like 30, 45 minutes away from his church, picks up boys and any of the other siblings or family that wants to come to church, takes them to church on Sunday morning. So now there are people going to church and hearing about God because of his heart to help these poor people who don't have the means to accomplish this on their own. This picture here was from a Christmas dinner. The organization that he works for, which is like a contracting organization with DPS, sponsored him picking the families of these boys that he helped and offering some Christmas gifts and some other support for them at Christmas time. So they had a dinner. They picked up all of these families, brought them to the church. They preached the gospel to them, shared this glorious message that Christmas is all about, the birth of our Savior, and blessed them. Even though he didn't have the means, someone else offered a check to sponsor this event here. But helping the poor. So I've given you a picture of helping the poor. Let's go to the next slide. I wanted to kind of talk about how the Bible talks about helping the poor, because I think that's going to be most helpful for us. So this is a couple of verses in Deuteronomy 15. Deuteronomy 15, if you're not familiar with it, is the year of Jubilee. That's where Moses is explaining to the people, to God, the ethics behind helping poor people. Verse 15 and 4 says, however, there need be no poor people among you, for the land the Lord your God is giving you to possess as your inheritance will richly bless you. He's saying, I'm blessing you. You didn't do anything to earn it. I'm blessing you with this. I'm giving you the power to get wealth. He says that later on in this block of teaching. And he's saying, hey, because I'm the one blessing you, there don't need to be any poor people around you. No poor people. That's God saying that, right? Down to 15 and 7. If anyone is poor among your fellow Israelite in any of the towns or the lands the Lord your God is giving you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward them. Deuteronomy 15 is this very profound passage because, quite frankly, it flies in the face of a lot of the ethics that our society espouses. You know, if Yahweh is their king and this is an ethic that he's commanding for their society, if our president or if our Congress advocated for some of these values, we would cry foul. We wouldn't want that. And this isn't about our politics. It's only to show the contrast, when I spoke earlier, the wisdom of our age, it's only to show the contrast of how we might think about things versus how God thought about things. And for us as Christians to reflect on where our heart should be. Next slide. Wisdom towards the prophecy. So good, skilled thinking, wisdom towards poverty. So here's a few proverbs. Proverbs 14 and 31. Whoever oppresses the poor shows contempt for their maker. But whoever is kind to the needy honors God. Proverbs 19 and 7. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done. Proverbs 29 and 7. The righteous care about justice for the poor, but the wicked have no such concern. This is how the Old Testament talked about the poor. Within God's kingdom, God has his nation of priests. They're all living together in this promised land, this land flowing with milk and honey that God has blessed them with. And this is the ethic that he's commanded them to live by, and this is the way that wisdom says this is righteousness. This is how you reflect God. Let's go to the next slide. When you get to the New Testament affirms basically everything that the Old Testament says in the law, which makes a lot of sense. Jesus is Jewish. His audience, the entire time of his ministry, is a bunch of Jewish people. And he's calling them to repentance. He's calling them to fidelity to the God that they have lost sight of and have not committed themselves to resolve to live for. Luke 4, 17 and 19, very famous passage, Jesus going into the synagogue reading, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news, the gospel, to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord." The year of the Lord's favor is the year of Jubilee, what we were just learning in Deuteronomy 15. So that's what the year of the Lord is. Even though this is a citation from Isaiah, it's referring all the way back to this Deuteronomy ethic. In that, a lot of, I've heard modern commentators, theologians say, put a spin on this where they say, well, this is about spiritual poverty. This is about spiritual imprisonment. The problem is the passage that he's referring to is not about spiritual. It's about like literal oppression and literal poor people and literal prisoners. And then if you go all the way back to Deuteronomy, it's about the same thing. It's a social ethic. It's how the society is supposed to live and reflect God's righteousness, God's wisdom. Jesus is saying those same ethics and values, God still cares about them. And I'm here, Jesus is here, to reestablish God's kingdom. And in such, Jesus himself, through his kingdom, is going to fulfill these very same things that God had already established. Let's go to the next slide. One of the, you know, just if it wasn't clear enough from this Luke passage, another passage that really highlights this point is Galatians chapter 2. So we know Galatians, Paul opens up warning this community of believers that he's established on his earlier missionary journey about how they have been going wayward. they had begun to believe in another gospel, a false gospel, right? And so Paul, during this letter, tells of this account how he goes to Jerusalem to speak to the leaders in Jerusalem to make sure that this message that he's preaching is accurate, is consistent, because they walk with Jesus. He had an encounter with Jesus. So he's going to validate his gospel. That's what he says at the beginning of Galatians chapter 2. The summary of that meeting is this. Actually, that's the wrong verse. It's actually, I think, verse 10, chapter 2, verse 10. That might have been an error by me if you go and looking for that. So he goes, all they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I had been eager to do all along. So if you go to Galatians 2, verse 9, Paul says, this is when I was in Jerusalem and I was validating my gospel, my good news message. This is the summary that they gave me, and it goes into verse 10, where verse 10 reads that. All they ask is that I remember the poor. Probably not the thing that we think of when we hear the word gospel or we think of the good news. We're probably not thinking about helping the poor, but as we can see, this was sort of a central ethic. How much so? Remember, Paul is traveling the world on his missionary journeys, establishing churches, and through these churches, he's saying, hey, back in Jerusalem, there's persecution to the Christians. They're struggling. They're having a hard life. Their fellow Israelites, they don't want to help them out. They don't want to do business with them because as far as they're concerned, they are betraying them by following Jesus. They're betraying the Jewish Judaism way by following Jesus. So there's suffering, financial suffering by the Jews in Jerusalem. So what does Paul do? He collects money. He goes around, collects money from other churches of means to take back to Jerusalem so that the church in Jerusalem, the Christians in Jerusalem don't have to suffer. Romans 15 and 26, for Macedonia and Achaia were pleased to make a contribution to the poor among the Lord's people in Jerusalem. That's what Paul's doing. That's what we do when we partner with churches like Metro Life or we partner with churches like the Prevailing Church. I want to commend to us to see those as great opportunities that we can resolve ourselves to reflect this ethic that God has called us to resolve to. Next slide. This should be the last slide. This is the last slide, and this is one of the things that stood out to me on one of my more recent readings of the book of Acts. It seems like as Luke is telling the story of the book of Acts, and when he brings up these like random stories related to things that's happening to Paul and Peter and such, he keeps highlighting with these random people this particular thing. Look at this. Acts chapter 9, verse 36. In Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha. In Greek, her name was Dorcas. She was always doing good and helping the poor. Remember that story about Dorcas? Is that what you recall? Is that the first thing that pops to your mind when you think of that story? That she was known for helping the poor. Or how about Cornelius, 10 and 4. Cornelius stared at him in fear. What is it, Lord? He asked. The angel answered, your prayers and gifts to the poor have come as a memorial offering before God. Is that what we think of when we think of Cornelius? Or how about Acts 24 and 17? After an absence of several years, I came to Jerusalem to bring my people gifts for the poor and to present offerings. That's Paul. Remember in Romans, he was talking about, still collecting gifts because Romans is after this event here. Even after this event, Paul is still collecting money and taking it to these poor people. Why? Because this is something that should be notable about God's people. We should have an orientation. We should be visibly seen for helping poor people. So I also want to offer one warning with helping the poor. In Galatians 6, I think it is, it says, do not get weary in well-doing. I've adopted this helping the poor as I've resolved myself that I'm going to help the poor. And I can testify to you, it gets hard. There are times where I feel like, God, haven't I given enough? And I hear the Spirit clearly telling me, no, trust in me. Trust in me. See, my wisdom of this world wants to think, okay, I've given more than the average person for this cause, and so God isn't that enough. And God just keeps calling me to continue to trust him. to continue to trust him, and I continue to trust him, and God has just been faithful, answering the prayers of my financial needs. And as a missionary, I have to fundraise, which ain't fun. I've never been fully funded as a missionary. I've been about 50% for 2 years, yet God has supplied every need. So I want to leave this with you guys today. New Year's is a time of year where we reflect on ways that we can pledge ourselves to bettering ourselves. Sometimes it's just personal. Sometimes none of these things are bad. If, you know, I'm overweight, so I certainly need to resolve to lose some weight, to eat healthier, fast a little bit more, do the things I need to do to lower my A1C and not become a diabetic, right? So it would be nothing wrong if I pledge to live a healthier life, which I actually do regularly, right? There's nothing wrong with pledging to manage my finance. All of these things are good, but equally good, and equally if not more valuable, is remembering that we are God's people, and we have been called to reflect God here on earth in tangible ways, and we can resolve ourselves to do that. And these are just a few ideas. Thank you.
Can I take that mic from you?
Thank you so much, Chris. Yeah, how are we going to remember the poor in this new year? How are we going to pursue justice this year? And how are we going to make it last past, you know, January 7th? It's definitely something I'm going to be reflecting on, so thank you for that, Chris. We're going to end our New Year's Eve service singing Prince of Peace. This is what I consider a classic UPBC song, so I hope you guys know it. Classic camp song, but if you don't, that's why we're singing it, so that we awaken it in this new generation as well, so it doesn't get lost in the past. So if you would stand and sing with us, it's an echo song, so we're going to have the guys sing with my dad over there, and the ladies echo with me, and then at the chorus, we all kind of sing these two different parts together. So the women follow us, okay, Quintana and I, and you and the guys, you follow Pastor D.
So the men are with me.
You got it.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
And I will follow.
I will listen.
And I will listen.
I will love you.
And I will love you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
I will sing.
Peace. You're dismissed.
I'll see.